Hi, my name is Jimmy Akinbola, and it's a pleasure to be here at Raindance fundraiser event. I think it's very special because a lot of the independent work is, I think, produced by people that maybe might not have access to the money like other people and to all the funding. And I think the budget's always a little bit smaller, but the work is so special. And I think there's a smaller pool of access for filmmakers to do that kind of work. And that's terrible. You know, there's been a lot of cuts in government and stuff like that. And I think there needs to be more opportunity to support independent film, because if you look at some of the hits over the years, it's crazy that there's not more to support independent filmmaking, you know, where it's such a small area to work from. And I think it's important that there are things like Raindance and lots of platforms to support independent film, to give it a platform to be seen by a wider audience and by the industry, to realize that we need to do more to support all these hard-working independent filmmakers, that some that are remortgaging their houses, some that are asking people to do things for free. And you know, that's cool, but in some ways it's not. It's like let's create a filmmaking business where independent film is fully supported, because I think it can be and it should be. First of all, the project spoke to me. I went to work with Aegis. No, but also what was important about it, I think, you know, the political discussion, you got stuff about immigration, but also I think there's not that much content on TV that has a family that happens to be black or African. This is the first in many years, or the first ever. But also, you know, what I loved about it, that it wasn't just about them being African, it was about them being a family in the heart of East London. And I think what Aegis has created in Sky and Green Door is that you can create great content that it crosses over universally, all sorts of people from different demographics, races and ages, they watched it, they enjoyed it. But also for me, that means that let's make more of that content, you know, let's trust, let's stop sort of going, well, we've not seen anything like that before, we don't know how it's going to go down. You know, if the content's good and you back it in its right way, that's like Sky backed in the long run, then we can have, I feel like, 10, 14 other types of in the long run. I don't mean comedies, I just mean, I mean inclusive, diverse content. That's what I mean, basically, you know? If you look at it, it's got great female characters, you know, it's got a great diverse cast, and also we had a great female director, the writer team was diverse, two women, two men, and, you know, and then you got, you know, the great producers as well. You got someone like Idris Elba, Gina Carter, and Charlie Hansen. I think, you know, when you look at the front and the back end of the show and how it's made up, for me, that's how sort of TV and film should be done. For Aegis, you know, him being back here in the UK now, I think he's conscious of the position that he's in. He doesn't have to do the work he's doing, but he's choosing to tell the stories he wants to tell, but also that fit in terms of what the current conversation is, and fits in with his speech that he did at the House of Commons, you know. And so, but also this is a personal story for him, so it was quite hard. His father passed quite a few years back, and so this is him sort of putting his personal story out there in the public. It's loosely based on his personal story, but it is. And so that's why I think it's important for him, but also he's very generous, Idris. He is trying to help bring talent through, just like, you know, just like myself. I've got a company called Trifles Creative Network, and we do initiatives like Monologue Slam UK is a free actor showcase to be seen by diverse actors. We do film festivals. You know, it's one of the cheapest in the world, you know, to submit your films and to be seen by people at BAFTA. And I think Idris is all about, let me use my position to open the doors of the industry, because it's still a bit closed off. There's still a bit of nepotism. There's still a bit, you know, middle class and white male. And it's nice that Idris and Green Door and Sky are creating content that is, you know, challenging that situation.
BAFTA has been actively taking steps like making diversity a requirement for eligibility to win BAFTA awards. Do you think those kind of things are necessary and helpful in terms of promoting active change, both on camera and off camera?
I do. I know a lot of people don't like it and they get a bit squirmish about it, but I think I'd rather go through the uncomfortable stage before we get to the good place. If you don't have things like this, then nothing's going to change. And what this does, this puts a spotlight on the issue. You know, there's a lot of talent that are not getting acknowledged for the work they are doing and have done. when you, because these things are not in place. And so I'm all for it. I'm like, you know, the Oscars, if you look at the Oscars, you know, how many more women, like, of the producers and directors that were in positions this year to win awards, you know? It was only about a 1-2% increase, but it was so important, you know? It's so important to acknowledge that and go, look, that's just the start. There needs to be more. So I'm all for it. I'm like, we need to keep going. It's not like a one-off. This is not like a nice little purple patch. For me, it needs to be better, get to the point where we don't have these conversations. But before we get to that place, it's going to be a bit sticky. And there might be some mistakes, but I'd rather have things being put into action rather than keep everything the same. We just talk about it.
Hello, I'm Christian Brassington.
Christian, it's fantastic to have you here with us tonight. Why is it so special and important to celebrate independent storytelling in particular?
I think that all great auteurs and great filmmakers all come from independent film. And I think it's really important to support that, because it's where a lot of great filmmakers get their start. And I think that big studio movies are fantastic and they look glitzy and great. And I think that the independent films can offer a sort of a slightly different voice, and maybe a more unique voice and a different sort of a more unique style. And I think it's really important that we support that.
In terms of support, I see you're wearing a ERA 50-50 badge. Can you talk about why that is a movement that you are yourself supporting?
I just think it makes perfect sense to me that men and women get paid the same for doing the same job. I can't put it any more simply than that. Just makes sense. Yeah, and it's the right thing to do, of course. Well, we've got the next series of Poldark, Series 4, coming out, and then I am off to do an independent British movie in Cornwall very shortly, which I'm really excited about.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, fans cannot wait for Season 4 of Poldark. Season 3 left us with some pretty big questions. Do you think fans are going to be satisfied with the way in which those are all answered and brought together in Season 4?
I don't know whether they're going to be satisfied. They might be disappointed at best, and probably more likely to be repulsed than anything else, I'd have thought. I'm sorry.
How does it feel to be part of a show that has obviously had such an extraordinary connection with an audience both here and around the world?
It's a huge privilege, first and foremost. I think that if you think about that too much when you're actually filming it, it could probably get overwhelming. But the response that I've had since I joined the show has been wonderful. And it's fantastic that so many people have connected with it and love it so much. We're really lucky. Yeah.
It's also one of the finest casts on TV. Can you talk a little bit about your experience working with an amazing team alongside you?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. They are wonderful. My very first day on Poldark was with Jack Farthing, and not only was he a lovely guy, but just to see him playing George Warlegan in front of me was a real treat. And everybody is so wonderful in it. I mean, Eleanor Tomlinson as Demelza, and Luke Norris, and I was very lucky to come in with Elise Chappell and Esme Coy as well. Just across the board, they're so wonderful. Yeah, we're really lucky. My fondest memories. I wonder what that would be. What's been my favourite bit? I think, in general, I enjoy the scenes where I'm sparring with Elise. I think they are the scenes that I enjoy the most. And I may or may not have a couple of scenes with Pip Torrens in the next series, and that is always a treat to be working with Pip Torrens.
We look forward to all of that and your independent film, and we're going to let you go and enjoy yourself tonight. I guess my final question, do you have a message for Poldark fans before you leave us?
I would like to say to the Poldark fans, I hope you enjoy Series 4, and I'm so, so sorry.
Hi, my name's Jeannie Spark. I'm a film and TV actress from London, UK.
Jeannie, it's amazing to have you with us tonight. Why is it so special and important to celebrate and support independent storytelling?
It's hugely important, because it's kind of, independent filmmaking is one of the few ways we have to safeguard the stories which otherwise wouldn't get told, which might not get picked up by broadcasting houses, TV companies, or film companies. I think if we can safeguard places like Raindance Film Festival, where independent filmmakers can tell their stories and get them out to a wider audience, that's absolutely invaluable. Otherwise, you know, we're going to just get a thin band of the same kinds of stories, and that's not what we need.
Collateral has had a phenomenal response. Can you talk a little bit about what it is about Sir David's writing that is so special, so unique as a performer?
He is, I mean, one of the greatest living playwrights that we have in the UK. And what I've always loved about him, from his stage shows as well as from his film work and now his TV work, is he's absolutely fearless. He's absolutely unafraid to take on big institutions like government, like the church, like the military, and ask really difficult questions. I just really admire that. Yeah.
I think obviously we've seen many different iterations of the spy world and the kind of consequences of that. Can you talk a little bit about what you think Collateral had to say about that was perhaps unique, something new in that field?
I think the link between the world of espionage and MI5 and the spy world with the ground politics of immigration, particularly in the UK, which is a really hot topic, I felt like it was integrated in a really good way in the Collateral script in a way that I haven't really seen before. I thought that was fantastic.
So it was a fantastic cast alongside you. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like working with that amazing team and particularly, I mean, a wonderful performance from Kerry Mulligan?
Yeah, I mean, she's astonishing. She's absolutely amazing. Yes, I was absolutely terrified on day one. I walked into the read-through and sitting around a table with Kerry and Nicola Walker, John Sims, and so many other actors who I've grown up admiring. I'm feeling a little bit like, oh my gosh, I have to really step up my game here. But it was an honour and a delight.
I think obviously there's a huge discussion going on at the moment involving ERA 50-50 and that change. Do you think that it's particularly inspiring to see shows like this, particularly crime dramas and espionage, that are being female-fronted, very much female-led in the narrative?
Yeah, I think it's enormously important. Women make up more than 50% of the population in the UK, and yet when we're represented on screen, we're lucky if it's one in three. Children's television, I think, represents three men for every one woman, which is not a message which is great for the next generation of kids to grow up seeing. So anything which promotes women and their visibility, you can't see what you can't be. So if a woman isn't in a position in a drama playing a doctor or a policeman, then we're always going to say policeman. We're never going to say police person or policewoman. So, yeah, it's important.
Why nights like tonight that champion independent storytelling still so important in 2018?
More and more. It's becoming more and more important. And what Elliot has done here with Raindance is second to none. You know, it's important to tell stories that aren't usually funded by big, huge studios. It's important to keep getting new, fresh talent coming through. And of course, this evening is about the fundraising for underrepresented or people who haven't got access to cash. You know, being creative and making a film shouldn't just be for a certain section of society. I mean, I know we all struggle getting funding, but I remember the applicants last year who won a bursary. Incredible. These guys would never have been able to fund a film and producing incredible stuff, and that's due to Raindance and Elliot's efforts.
When you're not celebrating here tonight, what do you have coming up the rest of the year? Where are we going to see and hear you next?
Okay, so I am in an Harlan Coben thriller called Safe, which is going to be on Netflix, and a French channel, which I think is C8. Also, I'm not sure when they're going to actually finish it, but a film called The Intent 2, an independent film, London-based. And I've never done a sort of urban London thing before, so that was fantastic working with the directors on that. Brilliant. So that's what I'm up to.
I guess my final question, obviously, having received your honour, how does that feel? Can you give your reaction now to get that kind of recognition?
Absolutely incredible. I'm still sort of reeling. I'm still overwhelmed by it all and still can't quite believe it, to be honest with you. But chuffed, you know, really, really chuffed, honoured.
Why is celebrating and supporting independent cinema so important in 2018?
It's so important because we have Netflix. We have, you know, people can stay in their homes and watch movies. To get movies made, financed independently in the current climate is almost impossible. So the fact that Elliot Grove and the Raindance team still champion independent film and give a platform for young and aspiring and up-and-coming filmmakers to break through is, you know, wonderful, miraculous, and you know, I'm so grateful that he's doing it. It's, if it wasn't for people like Elliot, independent film would be struggling even more than it is, because you know how hard it is to get a film financed, to get a film made, to get, you know, you've got Toy Story and Bond and Mission Impossible and Star Trek, Star Wars in the cinema, getting a release, it's so hard. So for young filmmakers to be able to work with people like Elliot to get independent films made is very, very important. So, and that's why I'm here, and that's why I always come to Raindance. I've recently moved out to the country because I'm just going to introduce my buddy Rock here. We have just co-directed a movie called 11. It's about the last 2 hours of World War One. These guys are all in the trenches and they think they're going home. And a big fat general who's 150 miles from the front line says, let's give these Germans one last punch on the nose. And 800 Commonwealth soldiers died in the last hour of World War One. And that's Rock wrote it, and it's coming out on Armistice Day, a very low budget independent film, but an important film about real important subject matter. So I'd like to introduce Rock, who co-directed it.
Originally it was because I've always been interested in that subject matter. But I realised, obviously, this year is the 100th anniversary of the armistice. And I don't think people are really going to be too interested, unfortunately, in the 101st anniversary, the 102nd anniversary. So 100 was a big milestone, you know. And so it was a calculated move, really, to write something about World War One and about... And I didn't want to just do a war film, because we've seen those over and over again, you know, men going over the top, big, loud, explosion. You know, this was more of a personal story about a group of guys in a trench who just want to go home. But some silly general decides, no, he's playing with his toy soldiers and he wants to just, oh, let him have a little go again at the enemy. And if they had just waited 20 minutes, they would have just walked home. You know, so it's and I wrote it not knowing that was a true story, you know. I thought, well, maybe this could have happened. And then after writing it, I found out, oh, it actually did happen.
This could have happened all the way along the front line.
Yeah, crazy.
It's the first film. I mean, I co-directed it and I play the main German in it, yeah. And I don't die. And I start off as you think I'm the villain because I'm doing the face, and I end up, I'm the guy that takes the message home to the family. Yeah. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but so it's nice for me to not die in a film, and I end up being a goodie.
Yeah.
The first time I was ever goodie, been a goodie. So it's like,
we're going to stretch him. We're going to stretch him, you see.
So instead of doing this face, I was doing this face.
Hi, I'm Jessica Piazzi.
Jess, it's brilliant to have you with us tonight. Why is it so special and important, do you think, to support independent storytelling?
I think it's so important for all of us, every crew, actor, everyone. I think it gives us a platform, it gives us chances to be seen, and I think that's the main ingredient to get where you want to be. So I've just literally yesterday wrapped on the 7 film, and it's a horror, and I get to play a character completely different to myself. I'm the villain. But you won't know until the end, which is great. And it was just a chance for me to show what I could do that wasn't the usual Dolly Bird type that I would normally get cast. So it was fantastic. I've had the best time filming and learning as well. I think I get to learn so much on these sets, and that's the main thing for me.
Obviously, it's a horror film. It's out on Halloween. Are you a horror fan yourself? Is it a genre that you've always been a passionate supporter of?
I did an interview years ago when I first left Italia Conti, my theatre school, and it was my dream was to do horror. I'm obsessed with horror films. Since 6 years old, I was watching The Exorcist. It wasn't normal. Really not normal. So I just love horror films. So for me to get to be in a horror film, playing a kind of crazy person, was exciting. So, that's definitely my favourite genre.
Obviously, of all the genres, sometimes horror gets kind of a bad rap for how it treats women. They're often seen as disposable or the victims. Do you think that's changing? Do you think we've seen a change in the horror genre in recent years?
Well, if I go by this film completely, because I was the badass girl. So I think so. I mean, I can understand if you look back into, like, what, the 80s, 90s, and you go to the Scream movies and it's boobs everywhere. And, you know, I think it is changing. I think more now our kind of horror films are more jumpy, and I think rather than the gory slasher, horror films that I love are the more the jumpy ones, which tend to not really make women look too bad. So I feel, you know, obviously with what's going on recently in the news, things do need to change and women need to be respected, I think. But if we generalise that, I think everyone in the world needs respect, from whether you're a man or you're a woman. There should be mutual respect all around, and if that's not being found, you know, because men aren't treating women in the right way in the industry, then that certainly needs to change. And I think now we're at a point where that is changing, and it's going to have to, especially with all the big press things that have been going on of late. I have the feeling, my personal views is, I am, you know, it's my body and I should do what I like with that body. If someone, you know, takes advantage of that, then that's unacceptable. But what I do is my choice. So also then we find a line here, the West End, we've got Showgirls. I know that they've stopped Grid Girls recently. And when does this line stop? If it's the woman's choice, then there should be no problem. I feel you're not being exploited. You know, if it's your choice and you want to do it, people need to just calm down. But on the flip side, if people are coming in and taking advantage, that's where the line needs to stop. As long as I just feel if it's your choice, it's your body, your choice, and you're happy, fine. But the minute that line's overstepped, then no good.
We've got seven that you've just wrapped on. Is there anything else you're working on? Anything else you're hoping to have coming up?
Well, I've just had some really good news, and I'm going for a script read through tomorrow with the whole cast. So I'm one to the other, pretty busy. But I don't know if I can say it. I haven't signed a contract yet, so I hate saying anything unless I've signed on the dotted line, because no, my luck. So I like to just keep it quiet, and then I will announce it if it goes. But it's something really big, and I'm super excited. It's such a huge industry in England and, in Europe, and independent film is really exciting, and you get to see all sorts of strange stories that, you know, aren't mainstream, that you wouldn't see, you know, in the usual Odeon and Views. And so, I mean, I'm a big geek, film geek, and I love seeing weird little independent films and documentaries. I always have done, and so Raindance in particular really champions things like that. And being an actress, obviously, it's my bread and butter. So I'm a big fan of earning money. So in the long run, it's one of my favourite jobs. It's been so much fun. There's all the music and stuff of the 80s, which just is so like vibrant and exciting, and massive floor fillers. And but aside from the music, politically, it isn't too dissimilar from now. We've got female in power. There's all sorts of stuff happening racially. There's all tensions building. It is very, very similar, weirdly, 1985 to nowadays. And I've really enjoyed getting my teeth into learning about that time, and have all the miners' strikes and Brixton riots, and I've really enjoyed it, like learning so much, and then the tunes, and Idris is cool, he's my boss, so it's a bit of a cool job for me.
Bill Bailey, your on-screen husband, can you talk a little bit about what it was like working with Bill, and how hard it is to keep a straight face when you're both wearing 80s attire as well?
Bill can rock a jumper like that. I don't know if you've seen some of the stuff that he wears, but he looks cool in them. Working with Bill's been great. He's a really intelligent, fun, naughty guy. He's a perfect second husband for me. I'm a big, big fan of his. We didn't sort of muck around too much, because we're both a bit nervous and wanting to get it right.
I believe there were some dance battles going on an offset. Who is the best dancer in the cast?
Not Idris. No, he can move. Sammy, who plays Idris, he's a really good mover. And Matty Boyd, who plays my son, he's like a little Billy Elliot. I threw some shapes as well, but I mean, everybody was pretty damn good at dancing, I've got to say. Yeah. What can people take away from it? Just like, life is short. Like, have fun and stand up for your neighbours and your friends and. I just think it's a story that's about friendship, and it's about family, and I think that's what the message is. Like, it's very family based, and I don't know about what people are going to take away all sorts of things from it, but I guess it shows like how history repeats itself, if anything.
Obviously, Idris is very much at the heart of this project. What makes him such a very special performer, do you think?
He's inspirational. It's his baby. It's his story. He's opened himself up. This is his life. It's about him coming over from, like I say, from Sierra Leone, and coming to England and his experiences as a young black boy. And you know, he's kind of like warts and all, and he takes the piss out of himself and out of the time. And you know, fair play to him. He's made it all happen. It's cool. He's cool.
I'm Ronan Summers, actor.
Right, it's amazing to have you here tonight. Why is it important to have nights like tonight where we celebrate the unique range of talent and achievement of independent cinema in particular?
Well, because independent cinema gets a hard run, doesn't it? I mean, there's so much stuff being made in the UK right now for big budget American stuff and big budget all sorts of stuff. But independent cinema, we have punch well above our weight. I say we, I'm a dual citizen, but... the UK punches well above its weight in terms of independent cinema, but the funding is sorely lacking, so the more that we can do to make, you know, beat the drum for independent cinema, the better, as far as I'm concerned.
What do you think it is that independent cinema offers both storytellers and an audience they perhaps don't get from other kinds of cinema?
Well, it gives opportunities to tell stories that are a little bit more daring, that maybe deal with more socially relevant material, and it gives actors and filmmakers and writers a real opportunity to stretch themselves and to make the things that maybe the multiplex audience doesn't want to watch, but that definitely serves a purpose for society and for audiences and for having a laugh and for just seeing something a bit different. You know what I mean? Well, June 22nd, we've got Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom, which is... obviously a huge movie, which is not independent, but I'm hugely, hugely excited about. And then Vikings, MGM Vikings, which comes out in 2019. I've just finished filming that in Dublin, so.
So we've just had our final trailer release for Fallen Kingdom today. How good a reflection do you think the trailers and clips are of what fans can expect from the whole film?
The movie is gonna be awesome. Everyone needs to just prepare for a real thrill ride. It's gonna be so much fun. Everyone who's involved, like J.A., who directed it, was just—I mean, he's actually an independently minded filmmaker. So it's actually a really nice crossover. And then Chris Pratt is just the biggest gentleman, and Daniela Pineda, and all those people are just such a great team. Justice Smith, it's going to be a real thrill ride. It's going to be lots and lots of fun. And it may not be independent, but I think because of J.A.'s influence, it might have a real independent spirit. I haven't seen it yet, so this is... He's a really great visual storyteller. I mean, I think A Monster Calls for me was just, I mean, it broke my heart, that movie. So he's got a really great balance between telling amazingly striking visual stories, but also finding those human elements as well, which I think, you know, that's, you live and die on those human elements. So I think that's why a film like Jurassic, which is so dependent on both, you know, so character-driven, but also so big on spectacle and CG and all that stuff. You need a filmmaker who's going to be able to tie it all together like that, and I think J.A. is the guy for the job, you know? I was never personally the victim of any pranks from Chris, but he's certainly an incredibly charming guy. It's not the first time I met him. I had a tiny, like, blink and you'll miss it part in Guardians of the Galaxy 1, which was great fun, and I spent a lot of wasted time on that movie kind of just sitting in my trailer waiting to get called, but it wasn't really wasted time because you're learning from guys like James Gunn and you have guys like Chris Pratt who are around the place, you know, just kicking up dust and having a great time and showing you that it's possible to be a legitimate leading man and also be incredibly charming and funny and nice and genuine. And, you know, Chris seems to be one of those guys who has not been changed by the fame and stuff. It was interesting actually meeting him on Guardians 1 because he wasn't quite the Chris Pratt that we all know yet. At that point, you know, he was still the guy from Parks and Rec, and he was still so humble and all that stuff. And I was a little bit worried that when that movie came out that he might lose some of that. But sure enough, he's continued to be a gentleman, which is kind of what you want from your movie stars, I guess.
Vikings, obviously a lot of excitement about that project as well. Can you tell us a little bit what we can expect and how you feel to be part of that?
So I will be popping up about halfway through season 6. So obviously, again, non-disclosure agreements are terrible for this sort of stuff. But I play a character called Herigar, who comes in. He's not Russian. He is one of the Vikings. And he does some things for Bjorn under the orders of Bjorn, and then feels the ramifications of those things. I'm afraid I've got to be really, really odd and shady about the whole thing, just because
We don't want you to get your head chopped off or anything. But I guess just my final question, just on the subject of Vikings. I mean, obviously, you can't tell us about what's coming up, but in terms of the success the show's been, I guess my final question, why do you think we are still so fascinated by that point in our human history?
Well, I think you've hit the nail on the head. I think that the show has really tapped into an incredibly romantic, impressive, mysterious time in human history, and they were so, I mean, the amount that those people and people who lived at that time in general, they put themselves through and were able to sustain and survive was just breathtaking. And I think we're in all of that now, because we live in such a soft, squidgy, you know, ready-made society where everything is disposable and easy to get, and you know, so when we see people that really live off the land and really, you know, And a masculinity that I think is kind of lacking in a lot of things, and in life in general these days. I mean, unreserved, unapologetic masculinity is a thing that I think creates a little bit of fantasy fulfillment, wish fulfillment for people, because back when men were men, you know what I mean?